No, I hate delivering bad news too. Right. Okay. Well, I'll let you know how it goes, and I'll talk to you soon. All right, thanks a lot.
Yeah, it's always disappointing to get cost feedback that isn't where you thought it would be. But, you know, that's the reality. These are real costs, you know? We make assumptions, and sometimes those assumptions don't work out.
Okay, so one of the most common problems, you're over budget. What do you do about it?
Yeah, so I just wanted to check with you and see kind of what your thoughts were on where we might start attacking this. Yeah. So you were thinking materials? Huh.
Now, although there's definitely savings to be had here, it's less than you might think, and here's why. When you're thinking about materials and you're gonna swap them, you're gonna change them to something else, you have to consider the labor that it costs to install that material equally. So let's say we have a material that costs $5 a square foot. And let's also assume that it costs $5 a square foot to install that material. If we decide to change that material for a material that costs half as much, so $2.50 a square foot, we don't automatically get to deduct half of the labor cost to install it. The labor cost is going to be the same, and in some cases, it actually might be more. So if we look at the total cost of our material savings, that's only a 25% net total savings. Yet we've made a material compromise. We have a material that we're probably not as happy with. Now, to do that on a broad scale, on a scale where you'd actually have to do it to save a big chunk of your budget, that's a huge ask. That's not an insignificant task. To save 50% on the wall finish, and here our wall finishes are only gypsum wallboard, so it's really difficult to save on that. Wall finishes, ceiling finishes, floor finishes, everywhere, tile, that's a really significant job. Now, one of the other places that we found in our project, we have shingles above the 7'6" level and we have shiplap below the 7'6" level. Shingles, I know, are very labor intensive to install. So one choice we could make is to swap the shingles for clapboards. Clapboards go up very quickly. We can have a lot of labor savings there along with the material savings. So I don't love that architecturally, but if that's a compromise that the client is willing to make, I think we should put it on the table to discuss. So I think that knee-jerk reaction to try and save a huge chunk of money by changing materials is flawed. Okay, so if trimming materials doesn't affect the budget in the way that we had hoped, what does? Well, reducing scope is where you really want to start. It's going to have the most impact on your budget. And when we're talking about reducing scope, we're talking about trimming square footage. There's a couple of things to know about reducing square footage. The first is it's not a linear deduction. Let's just say for our example's sake that we're able to build based on this estimate for $100 per square foot. If we trim 100 square feet, we don't automatically save $10,000. And this is because as the building square footage goes down, the remaining square footage tends to go up in price. And that's because we have certain infrastructure costs, things like kitchens and bathrooms and a heating plan and a foundation. And these items tend to be relatively expensive. So as you reduce the square footage, the remaining square footage tends to go up in cost. So if we're talking about $100 per square foot cost to build, we might be able to only take a $75 per square foot credit back as we're trimming square footage. Now, the other thing to think about when you're trimming square footage is not all spaces are equal. Obviously, a kitchen square foot is not equal to a hallway square foot. A hallway may cost $50 a square foot to build, while a kitchen costs $500 a square foot to build. So you need to be smart and strategic as you're doing the trimming. Okay, let's compare this with the material savings we were just discussing. With the square foot savings, you're affecting every single line item in the budget. Saving 100 square feet means you're reducing roof and wall framing and insulation and finishing costs and heating costs and foundation costs and site costs. So you can see it has an outsized impact on the budget. Now, not surprisingly, this will be a place where you encounter some resistance, maybe from yourself because you're in love with the design, maybe from your client. It's natural that we just want what we want, but we want it to cost less. But this is a place to be brutally honest with yourself and your client. Something has to give in order for the estimate to go down, and trimming square footage is one of the best ways to save. there are ways to simplify every single project. You've probably heard this concept about limiting the number of jogs in your foundation as a way to save money, as a way to control costs. And that's not because, you know, concrete work is necessarily expensive. It's usually not. But it has this ripple effect. By putting a corner in the foundation, it means you need to cut the framing at the corner. It means you have trim to put on the inside and the outside. It means more labor. It means more finishing costs. It means the framing can't just continue along in an uninterrupted row. It affects all the components of the building as opposed to just one singular component. So simplifying means taking away complexity. And a simple building can be every bit as elegant if you proportion things correctly and if you're smart about your design moves. Here in our project, we can look at eliminating the bump outs. We can look at eliminating decks and the fireplace storage nooks. Now, these are all things that my client loves, and they're part of the thing that makes the design what it is. And so at some point, we have to sort of reconcile these ideas and these cost savings with what we're giving up, and is that worth it? And that final calculus is up to your client. There are some choices that are better for the architecture, and there are some choices that are worse for the architecture, and it's your job just to sort of illuminate what those are for your client. So naturally in the design process, there's gonna be some things that are just out of your control. We have a tariff on imported wood products. We have local labor shortage. There's a couple of huge projects that are drawing big labor pools. So there's a lot of demand in the housing market, which again, raises prices. This is definitely a seller's market, not a buyer's market. And those are things you just can't possibly control. The thing you can control is the flow of information, how you gather information from estimators, contractors, subcontractors, and present it to your client. These are real facts. You can't make these materials cost any less. You can only provide the options and the choices for them to make informed decisions. And the best thing you can do is have these discussions early. So we're having this discussion now before all the drawings are finalized, before all the plans are done, before the client has spent a huge architectural fee resolving a design that ultimately they couldn't afford. So we're doing this at schematic design so we can get a price check and say, all right, are we even in the right ballpark? And if we're not, then we can change the design before we've made all of these decisions hard and fast, before the client has become completely invested in the design. And sure, they're excited about things. These are difficult conversations to have no matter when they happen, but it's much better to have them here in the studio before a construction crew mobilizes, before you commit to a huge financial outlay that you're unsure you can commit to following through on. So your job as an architect is to orchestrate all of this work and provide information and be as dispassionate about it as you possibly can. Sure, you care about the design. I wanna see this thing built just like my client does, and I'm really invested in the design and the whole process behind it, but it's gotta work for the client on a financial level. If they can't afford it, it's just not even a reality. You have to get good at these things as an architect. These are things they don't teach you in school, but you need to figure out how to get your work built, and that means from a financial standpoint, from a technical standpoint, you need to work with your client, with the contractors, the subcontractors, your consultants. It takes all these parts and pieces, and it's a complex puzzle, but it's definitely doable. So where does that leave this project? Hey, so what's your, I know you're really slammed here for the next couple of months, but I wanted to kind of check in with you on schedule to see what you're up to kind of late summer. Yeah? All right. Okay, cool.